Hello, everyone. We're going to go ahead and get started. Welcome to the Honors College Winter Research Showcase for 2021. I'm Tony Doolin, Dean of the Honors College, and I'm very excited that so many members of our community have joined us for what I'm sure will be a fascinating and fun set of presentations. As you'll probably have noticed, we are in a Zoom room with lots of boxes, and we're doing that so that we can go to breakout rooms after the presentations. If you're not familiar with Zoom, if you go to the view and change it to speaker view, you'll be able to see the different students as they pop up to do their presentations. So that might be a slightly better way to manage the first part of this session. Also, before we get started, you might notice that we're recording the presentations today. The final video will be edited to remove any identifying information about those of you attending before we do any sharing or posting. Our event tonight is hosted by two members of the Honors College Board of Regents, our External Advisory and Development Board, Paul Lorenzini and Mary Carlin Yates. Mary and Paul have been wonderful supporters of Oregon State University, and I've been so grateful for their commitment to the Honors College and to our honors students. Paul?
Yeah, thank you, Tony. Thank you all for being here. I have two grandchildren, and I suppose like most parents and grandparents, I worry about their access to higher education. And of course, there's the financial issue, but there's also the issue of quality, an education that inspires and challenges their potential and builds something within them that that can be permanent and lasting. We worry about that as grandparents. So we also worry about that as leaders in our community. How do we retain our most talented young people to serve our communities? What's excited me about participating in the Honors Program is that it's a program especially designed to attract, to challenge, to inspire, and to provide that kind of an educational experience for our most promising young people. We often think about that as intellectually most gifted, but it's much more than that. It's those that are the most enterprising, the intellectually curious, the motivated. And it's all right here in River City, if you might say. I'm proud to be here today and with my colleague, Mary Yates, co-sponsor this event to showcase a small sampling of those students who are part of this program. So you can see for yourselves just what the Honors Program is all about. So we thank you for being here.
Thank you, Paul. And thank you, Mary, for your support for our event tonight. We are fortunate in our friends here in the Honors College and fortunate to count among them leaders from across the university. I'm very pleased tonight to welcome OSU Provost and Executive Vice President Ed Fazer to our event. Since arriving at OSU a bit more than 4 years ago, Provost Fazer has been a tremendous champion of the Honors College and of our commitment to inclusive excellence. And I'm so happy he was able to join us today to see that excellence on display. Prior to joining us here at Oregon State, Provost Fazer held several leadership roles at the University of Illinois at Urbana-Champaign, including Interim Provost and Vice Chancellor for Academic Affairs, Dean of the College of Fine and Applied Arts, and Head of the Department of Urban and Regional Planning. He also held a chair at the University of Manchester in the UK, and a professorship at the University of North Carolina, Chapel Hill. Here at OSU, he is a professor of public policy, and his own research expertise is in regional economic development, innovation and technology policy, public policy and management, strategic planning, and regional economic modeling. As provost, he is the chief academic officer at Oregon State, and he leads in the implementation of OSU's strategic plan and student success initiative, growing the university's research and impact, supporting faculty and graduate student success, and close to our own heart in the Honors College, expanding diversity, inclusion, and success in the undergraduate community. Provost Fazer, thank you for joining us.
Thank you, Tony. Thanks so much for having me tonight. It's really a delight to be here and to hear the students' work. Students, I know you're going to do a fabulous job. Really looking forward to hearing your research. Thanks, Tony, for your inspiring leadership at the Honors College, which has grown the college immeasurably since Tony's been in her role, strengthening OSU as a whole. This is a great opportunity tonight to hear from a select group of Honors College students to share their research, but it's also a showcase for the quality of the work of all of our Honors College students. So I see it as an opportunity to just hear about the kinds of things all of our students are doing. As Oregon's land-grant research university, we seek to provide an inquiry-based education to all undergraduates, and the Honors College furthers that mission by providing highly motivated students with a transformative experiential learning opportunity in research, scholarship, or creative work through the honors thesis and unique internship, leadership, service learning, and other coursework and co-curricular programming. Through the honors thesis, Honors College students collaborate with faculty all across OSU. So this is an exceptional learning opportunity for students, but as you're going to see tonight, I think it's a tangible service to researchers. The Honors College and the work of our students in the college make us a stronger research university. They're real contributors to OSU's scholarship, and their work often leads to presentations at conferences and to publications. And as outstanding as our students are, their success is dependent on the support of partners from across the university and beyond, people like Mary Carlin Yates and Paul Lorenzini. I want to thank them, add my thanks for their steadfast support of the Honors College and for all of Oregon State. We wouldn't be the kind of university we are without the support of people like Paul and Mary. The 1,500 students currently in the Honors College embrace OSU's mission to create a better future for Oregonians in the world. While they get their start here as undergraduates, we know they'll go on to be intellectual innovators, visionary change makers, and leaders well beyond their time at Oregon State. So through the presentations you hear tonight, I hope you'll be just as impressed as I am with the quality and commitment of Oregon State's Honors College students. Thanks very much for coming tonight. Thanks very much for your support of the college. And now back to you, Tony, for your remarks and presentations.
Thanks so much, Ed. Now it is my great pleasure to welcome our 10 student presenters. As Provost Fazer mentioned, research is at the heart of the Honors College experience and has been a fundamental part of honors education at Oregon State, dating back to the honors program that preceded the establishment of the Honors College in 1995. As an opportunity for personal growth and learning, research is unique, providing skills and confidence that honors graduates carry with them throughout their lives. But as you'll see in tonight's presentation, the work students do represent real contributions to their fields as well. Our 10 presenters tonight are at varying stages in their research process, but together they truly do showcase the diversity and depth of the research accomplishments of OSU's Honors College students. We've asked each student to speak briefly, just around 3 minutes, about their work, and we'll go through all 10 talks without a break. After everyone has gone, we'll split into 5 breakout rooms with 2 students in each room. Many of you have been pre-assigned to a starting room, but you are free to visit other rooms as well. And if you weren't pre-assigned, Tricia Riley and Kelly Parker will help you get into one of the breakout rooms. In the chat, we'll post the link to a website with all of the slides and titles and a list of which speakers are in each of the rooms. And now it is my pleasure to invite Brinley Kozai to begin our presentations. Brinley?
Hello, my name is Brinley Kozai and I'm an undergraduate animal science major, and I will be sharing with you the results of my research on sperm protein reactive with anti-sperm antibody in equine ovaries, and it is also known as SPACA 3 or SPRASA. Next slide, please. SPRASA is a unique intra-acrosomal conventional type lysozyme-like protein of mammalian spermatozoa as shown in the picture on the lower right. In humans, SPRASA has been identified as a biomarker for male fertility, and women often have higher levels of SPRASA antibodies when infertile in comparison to fertile women. SPRASA is first expressed in cap-based spermatids during spermatogenesis on the inter-acrosomal membrane in men, cattle, sheep, and deer. In females, SPRASA has been localized to the zona pellucida and ooulemma of isolated bovine oocytes, as well as granulosa cells and ooplasm in dogs and cats, as shown in the top right image. The wild horse and burrow population within the United States has exceeded the carrying capacity of the public lands where they are managed by around 55,000 horses. From an ecological perspective, native plant communities are not well evolved to withstand equine grazing, and potential diet overlap between wild horses, livestock, and wildlife limits the accessibility of food resources. In addition, it is inhumane to leave the wild horse and burro population unattended due to the likelihood of the wild horses starving to death on the range. Current methods for male sterilization include castration and vasectomy. Both castration and vasectomy will render a stallion infertile. However, this has affected organization and harem integrity, and there has been reproductive success of bachelor stallions. Additionally, population control efforts have focused on mares, and current methods for mares include temporary immunocontraception against porcine zona pellucida or gonadotropin-releasing hormone, which both reduce the chances of pregnancy. However, they need to be readministered to maintain immunocontraception. Ovariectomy will result in permanent sterilization, but this method is highly invasive and painful and requires specialized skills and facilities. Therefore, we hypothesize that Sprasso would be immunoexpressed in primordial, primary, secondary, and tertiary equine follicles, and we also hypothesize that Sprasso would be immunolocalized to granulosa cells and ooplasm. Routine immunohistochemistry was performed on formalin-fixed, paraffin-embedded ovarian sections from 16 mares. Sprasso was expressed in equine primordial follicles and primary follicles, as shown in the top image. It was also expressed in secondary granulosa cell follicles in the middle image and tertiary follicles in the lower image. To the best of our knowledge, this is the first report of Sprasso immunoexpression in the equine ovary. And our laboratory is currently working to develop and test a Sprasso vaccine for horses beginning this spring and summer. This vaccine could induce an immune-mediated ovaritis, resulting in permanent non-surgical sterilization. Next slide, please. We are also interested in investigating what role Sprasso may play in equine granulosa cell tumors. Immunohistochemistry was performed on neoplastic tissue from 5 mares with granulosa cell tumors and was positive for Sprasso, as illustrated by the black arrows on both images. Thank you.
Hello, my name is Alana Gottfriedley, and I'll be talking briefly about engineering translational machinery for the efficient production of unnatural proteins. I do research in the unnatural protein facility in the Department of Biochemistry and Biophysics here at Oregon State. My advisors are Dr. Rick Cooley and Ryan Mell. First, I just want to make sure everyone is on the same page as to why proteins are so important, as to why we want to study them. Proteins are these incredible macromolecules that are involved in every life process. This is because they catalyze or regulate nearly all the chemical reactions that occur in a cell. Proteins are super diverse in both their structures and functions. On the top right, I've included structures of some particularly pretty proteins. The diversity of proteins allows them to be involved in many processes such as metabolism, replication, movement, and cellular structure. Now on to what my lab focuses on. The diversity of natural proteins is afforded by just 20 naturally encoded amino acids. The sequence of these amino acids determines how the protein will fold and ultimately the function it will have. In the unnatural protein facility, we develop a methodology called genetic code expansion. Genetic code expansion allows us to encode unnatural amino acids. We do this by engineering enzymes that are involved in the cellular process of protein synthesis called translation. Now you might be wondering at this point, why would we want to be able to encode unnatural amino acids into proteins? Using these unnatural amino acids, we can introduce functions into proteins that are simply not possible with the natural set of 20 amino acids. In the bottom right, I have an example of this. By encoding highly fluorescent unnatural amino acids, we can track where proteins are localized in live cells. We can also use unnatural amino acids to do things like attach proteins to materials, mimic disease states, and even turn proteins on and off with light. Now onto what my research focuses on. The first project I'm working on is solving the structures of these engineered enzymes using X-ray crystallography. Crystallography is an awesome technique where we use a concentrated solution of the enzyme of interest combined with a variety of other reagents to grow these beautiful crystals. I have a few of them pictured on the left that I've grown recently. We can then shoot X-rays at the crystals and collect the diffraction pattern. The diffraction pattern is used to solve the structure of the enzyme. With the structures, we can better determine what pathway to take when we engineer the enzymes further. The second project I work on is developing a new strategy to improve genetic code expansion systems. In this graph, on the y-axis is fluorescence, which is a measure of how well the system is working. The bar on the left is for an old genetic code expansion system. On the right, you see my new system that can produce about 2 times as much unnatural protein as the old system. Currently, I am wrapping up and expanding on both of these projects while I write my thesis. Research has been by far the most important part of my experience at Oregon State University, and I greatly appreciate the support I have received from both of my mentors in the lab and the Honors College. Thank you all for coming this evening and listening.
Hi everyone, my name is Julia Zavala. I'm a fourth year biology student with a minor in psychology, and I will be talking to you today about my research on disparities in help seeking and treatment for depression in students of color in college. Next slide. Research on disparities in mental health like depression in students of color in college has been limited. Vulnerable populations like those from minoritized backgrounds indicate that they do not believe mental health treatment would help them. And on average, minority groups experience mental illness at sometimes similar rates to whites. Lastly, people of color have lower treatment than their white counterparts. The purpose of this study was to evaluate the differences in rates of depression, treatment, and personal stigma and perceived stigma for students of color in college. And to see if these statements hold true. We used data from the Healthy Minds Studies 2019 survey. They used nationally representative random sample over 79 participating institutions in the US. Next slide. They found that 36% of students show depression, 14% show help seeking such as counseling and therapy, 47% have perceived public stigma, which means that they agree with the statement that most people would think less of someone who has received mental health treatment, and 6% agree with the statement, I would think less of someone who has received mental health treatment, personal stigma. Next slide. When looking at the ethnic comparisons through chi-square analysis, we found that treatment rates and perceived stigma rates were not statistically different between the ethnic groups. However, they were for depression rates and personal stigma with a low p-value. So what does this mean? Next slide. From the 36% of students with depression, the rates are different between the ethnic groups. Also, few students actually exhibit personal stigma at about 6%. However, the rates in the ethnic groups are very different. Almost half of college students consistently among the ethnic groups worry about perceived stigma, and rates of help seeking are similar among these groups as well. This might be due to students having more access to mental health resources that are inclusive. If we were to look at the general public, we might see something different. Limitations include lack of access to the raw data and limitations in statistical analysis with only chi-square, which we look to establish later in the rest of my honors thesis. So it's important to educate institutions on the different rates and stigmas in mental health for students of various ethnic backgrounds. We need to bridge the gap between the different depression rates in these communities of color in college in comparison to their counterparts. Further research into these discrepancies will help address these problems, a topic I will consider in the rest of my honors thesis. Thanks so much.
Hi there, my name is Janie Anderson and I'm a fourth year, or a senior, I'm a sixth year student, studying music education with a minor in popular music study. And my thesis is entitled Equity and Gender Bias in High School Music Programming in the Pacific Northwest, a case study with my faculty advisor, Dr. Dana Reason. Next slide. Before I talked about the background of my thesis, I wanted to give a quote from really a very famous music education book saying, once women begin to compose, it is hardly any longer the body that features in the activity at all, for composition involves a metaphorical display of the power of mind. This cerebral power conflicts with patriarchal constructions of femininity to the extent that when it is harnessed by women, it produces a threat to the sexual order, by Lucy Green, Music Gender Education. Next slide, please. The history of music education in the United States follows both the history of European art music as well as United States military bands. Historically, women and BIPOC have been omitted in both of these histories, except for examples of tokenism. And tokenism is the policy or practice of making only a symbolic effort. One example of this is the very famous composer slash educator Nadia Boulanger. She influenced hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of musicians, including some such as Aaron Copland, who is world famous. And recently I took a graduate studies music test, and there were over 200 questions, and there was only one question talking about a woman. And the only reason they talked about a woman, in this case Nadia Boulanger, was because she had taught famous men who were after her. Next slide, please. So my thesis is specifically asking how are educators in band classrooms involving women in BIPOC musical works. Next slide. Part of music education in Oregon is taking your ensembles to festival. And in the state of Oregon, there is a required literature list for performing. And on this required literature list, there's 143 composers, and there's some composers are used over and over and over again. There's one woman and 142 men on this list, which is very saddening to me. But my hope is that with this research, I can ask teachers how they are involving women in BIPOC in their classrooms and educating their students on more diverse composers. Next slide. And so my research examines current music education practices and specifically addresses gender bias and inequities in music education. Thank you so much.
Hello, my name is Simone, and I will be talking about how invasive species may affect fire behavior in the Ochoco National Forest. Next slide, please. I wanted to start with a few acknowledgments. I want to thank Claire and Meg, my thesis advisors. I also want to acknowledge where the funding for this project comes from, as seen on the screen. Next slide, please. Invasion by Ventinata dubia, a small invasive grass species around 3 inches tall, has the potential to affect fire behavior patterns across the Intermountain Pacific Northwest. The scabland ecotype found in the Ochoco does not have a history of burning or invasion by annual grasses. This makes these sparsely vegetated ecosystems natural fire breaks for wildlife and wildland firefighters. Next slide, please. My project aims to understand how a change in present invasion levels can affect fire behavior in 3 non-forested ecosystems found within the Ochoco: wet meadow grasslands, low sage shrublands, and stiff sage scablands. When creating models to simulate fire behavior, a main consideration is vegetative structure. In this project, this was addressed through a biomass index. Plant matter was collected in field and weighed in lab. I developed input parameters based on biomass data to run in a fire modeling software. Next slide, please. An important aspect of fire spread is the proximity of vegetation, which is referred to as fuel connectivity. I expected to see that the rate of spread in the low and stiff sage sites would show more susceptibility to change with an increase in invasion. In wet meadow sites, I predicted little to no change in rate of spread at all levels of invasion. However, this was not the case. Only the stiff sage site followed the hypothesis that increases in ventinata will lead to increases in rate of spread. The low sage sites showed rate of spread increases in the presence of ventinata, but that the amount of ventinata present did not significantly change the rate of spread of the fire. In wet meadow sites, I found that rate of spread is affected by large inputs of ventinata. Next slide, please. The effect on rate of spread that ventinata shows in these models means that an invasion by ventinata will need to be considered in decisions regarding fire management. The Ochoco practices prescribed burning in the dry ponderosa forests, as fire is essential to the ecological health of the Ochoco system. Scabland fires historically are rare and small. These barren spots in between ponderosa stands are essential for wildland firefighters as safe zones to facilitate prescribed burns. These models show that in invaded stiff and low sage sites, fire will burn in larger patches than in uninvaded sites, minimizing the effectiveness of these areas as fire breaks. Next slide, please. Thank you.
Right. Hi, all. My name is Maya Bergman. I am a fourth year studying environmental science with a minor in soil science. And today I'm going to be telling you a bit about my research project associated with the Deloach Scholarship. So for my project, with the mentoring of Aaron Rooney and the support of Dr. Librand, Dr. DeMore, and Dr. Foss, I looked at the carbon storage and distribution in coastal temperate rainforests. And we had the following objectives. One, for me to get introduced to and trained in the use of GitHub and RStudio, which are used for coding and data processing. Two, to gain experience in extracting specific data for soil resource from resource soil resource databases and spreadsheets. In this case, pulling from carbon data from a spreadsheet with over 1,000 soil pentons. And three, to use the extracted data to produce comprehensive figures, which is what we are going to be looking at in the next couple of slides. So Kevin, next slide, please. Thank you. Here we see three figures representing soil pH that were made in the process of learning how to take a good amount of unfiltered data to filter said data and to also manipulate how it is represented within the figures. For the leftmost figure, you see that while it is presenting the data we are looking for, it is also difficult to read and interpret, as there is no depth information, a lack of differentiation between mapped mythological unit versus parent material, as well as duplications or complete absence of data. With the second figure, we see that with a few more lines of code, we have now made the data a bit clearer and more understandable, as we have now added depth into the figure and removed landform duplications. However, it is still difficult to interpret the mapped lithological unit versus parent material as they are not represented separately. So with the rightmost figure, we have solved this problem as depth, pH, landform, and parent material are all differentiated from one another, and the data is now able to be interpreted. So for instance, we can see that the ridgetop landform with both tantalite and volcanic parent material have a direct negative linear relationship between pH and depth, because as the depth increases, so does the pH. Kevin, next slide, please. Thank you. So here you can see the figures that we created for the final part of this project, specifically looking at the total soil carbon across Juneau soils. So for the left figure, we are looking at the carbon content of colluvium-based soils, or soils consisting of transported debris versus the landform. And we can see that backslope has both a lot of data as well as a large variation between carbon content, which makes sense given that of the three landforms, landform positions represented, backslope is likely to have the higher accumulation of organic material due to less erosion and more potential for vegetative growth. For the right figure, we are looking at the carbon content of three soils with different parent materials versus landform. And there are a couple different things that we can take away from this figure. First, we once again see that the backslope landform has a lot more data, while shoulder is no longer present, which is likely due to the fact that the shoulder landform experiences the most erosion, so the carbon values are likely extremely low, or there just is insufficient data for the sites. We also see that the total carbon content stays relatively constant with increased depth in both landforms. Finally, the higher amount of variation seen between the backslope data for both figures is likely attributed to the parent material, as different materials have different mineralogical properties, leading to a variation in carbon content. So with all of this in mind, the hopeful next steps for this project is going through the process of data extraction and figure production for other attributes of the soil data in hopes of making further connections between parent material and landform and other aspects of the soil, such as nitrogen content or horizon designations. So thank you. And now I'm going to pass it off to the next presenter, David.
Hi. My name is David, and I'm a senior in chemical engineering. Over the past year and a half working in the Department of Chemistry, I've been working with a class of porous material called metal organic frameworks for applications involving CO2. So on the next slide, metal organic frameworks, or MOFs, are a type of crystalline material that are formed when you have a network of metal ions coordinated to organic compounds or ligands. So under certain reaction conditions, you can actually coordinate these metal ions using the ligands as a linker or bridge to form various structures from one-dimensional chain all the way up to three-dimensional structures. So on the next slide, from those chemical reactions, you can actually generate mock crystals, which then you can use crystallography technique or microscopy, such as single crystal X-ray diffraction, to sort of study their structure and elucidate their chemical properties. And one of the main advantages of these materials is that they're highly porous, very modular because of their starting material and your reaction condition. You can tune them to various applications. And one such application on the next slide is using it to selectively capture CO2 from various gas mixture. And in particular, we studied using biogas, which results from the breakdown of organic matters from common sources such as livestock, food waste, and agricultural residues. So using our material, as you can see in the middle, you can pack this within a column, so sort of like a packed bed column, and remove the CO2 from the biogas by passing the biogas through the column. And therefore you can purify the methane, which biogas contains up to 60% of. And this methane can be used as a fuel source for industrial, home, and vehicles because it is fairly cleanly combustible and therefore efficiently can be used as a fuel source. And the result of this work is that we were able to publish at the beginning of this year in the journal Applied Materials Today. And on the next slide, a step above on that, using captured CO2, we can use another MOF to convert the CO2 into value-added products, such as hydrocarbons for fuel and lubricants or alcohols. So as you can see with this particular MOF over here, it has pores that CO2 can enter and be captured, but using some sort of starting material, such as this class of material called epoxy, you can actually fix this epoxy upon the MOF and use the MOF as a catalyst in which your chemical reaction with your CO2 in the presence of time and presence of heat and with time can be accelerated. So you use less energy and can do it in quicker amount of time. And from this epoxy, if we fix CO2 upon it, you can actually form a class of chemicals called carbonates, which can be used as electrolytes in lithium batteries. And as you can see with our setup down there in our autoclave reactors, we were able to achieve up to 97% conversion rate in only 12 hours using our material and process. And this work has been going on for about a year. So we're sort of in the end stage of preparing for publication and submission, hopefully in April. And this is gonna be the basis of my thesis. And I'm very excited to hopefully publish as a first author rather than a co-author. And with that, sort of a quick summary of what you can do with MOFs in terms of carbon capture and conversion. And this is a very exciting field that is very emerging and very competitive, where our material has no limits except for the sky in terms of how much CO2 you can convert and capture. And thank you.
Hi, my name is Kaylin Moore, and I'm a senior in mechanical engineering with a minor in aerospace engineering, and I'm conducting research under Dr. Kyle Niemar. I'm going to be talking about using genetic algorithms to reduce chemical kinetic models in an open source platform called PyMARS. So next slide, we're going to break this down. And first, we're going to understand what chemical kinetics is. And then we're going to go into the details of genetic algorithms and how I'm bringing those all together. So first up, chemical kinetics is a branch of physical chemistry concerned with understanding the rates of chemical reactions. This is in contrast to thermodynamics, which is more like a black box in which you give inputs of a reaction and it will tell you the outputs. Chemical kinetics seeks to understand the individual mechanisms of the chemical processes in a reaction. This is actually really applicable to many different fields, such as cosmology, biology, geology, engineering, even psychology. However, there's a trade-off in developing these chemical kinetic models, because if you want a large amount of detail of the individual steps of a reaction, that means you're having very large models. They have thousands of species and take up a lot of computational time to run. So there's a large field that goes into developing ways to reduce these models, removing species that are not contributing to the overall parameters, and so finding a way to shrink the size of the models so they're more useful but still maintaining accuracy. Next slide, please. So the next idea, genetic algorithms. So genetic algorithms refer to the mathematical method of optimizing a solution based off of the theories of evolution. So they use things like randomness that is inherent in nature as a means of breeding solutions so that you arrive at a fittest individual. As you can see on this kind of graph here, you start off with an initial population. This can be based off of a best guess or randomly generated. You're going to be conducting a fitness assessment using related parameters to evaluate the likelihood of individuals in the population of being a good candidate. Then you choose the best ones, and then you're going to perform a set of crossover and mutations to these individuals to sort of simulate the random changes that occur when new generations occur in nature. And then you evaluate this new population. And if the model is within the error tolerance that you're looking for, you're done. If not, then that is your new initial population and you start over again until you're within your stopping criteria. For chemical kinetic models, this looks like optimizing the coefficients of a reaction rate equation governing that model and developing the most efficient way to determine the fitness of those individuals. So bringing this all together, I'm developing software that is going to contribute to the existing PyMARS Python package. This is an open source package that was developed by a previous Honors College student under Dr. Niemeyer. This package can already reduce chemical kinetic models using different methods such as direct relation graph with error propagation, path flux analysis, and sensitivity analysis methods. My work will be adding another option for users to use to reduce their models. This provides more options and more flexibility and will hopefully prove to be a more efficient method to quickly reduce file sizes. This is specifically being developed for reducing liquid propellant combustion models because these are particularly large, and it pairs with the work that I'm doing on the high altitude liquid engine team for my capstone project, and it's an exciting opportunity to contribute work into the aerospace field. Thank you to the Honors College and the Deloach Scholarship for giving me the opportunity to conduct this research.
Hey everyone, my name is Patrick. I'm a fourth year student studying biology with a pre-vet option and a minor in chemistry. I'm currently doing research on how the COVID-19 pandemic has affected the relationship between dogs and their owners in the United States. Really quickly, I just want to thank the Honors College for allowing me to present my research and also my thesis mentor, Dr. Michelle Kutzler as well. Next slide, please. I became interested in this topic because we know somewhat how the pandemic has affected the lives of humans, with new cases coming in every day last spring and summer, causing social isolation, which led to many depressions and any different kind of mental illness, anything like that. But we don't know how it has affected the lives of companion animals, such as dogs. The actions we had to take, such as quarantining with our pets or changing our daily routine, have shown to have affected dogs' mental states in the past. But we haven't had any research done with it here in the United States. Other countries such as Spain and Israel have been doing research in stuff like this, but not here as of yet. Next slide, please. To accomplish this, I actually created a survey that asked questions about the beginning of the pandemic, which I quantified as March 2020, based on the overall country's quarantine, since every state had a different time frame. And also the current time frame of taking the survey during this time frame right now. I did have to use the owner's observations in my data, but I designed my questions specifically to avoid any issues that might arise because of sample bias or lack of memory. I myself can't remember anything that I did this morning, so I can't expect anyone to remember what they did almost a year ago. So I made my questions very unique to make sure that they only answered multiple choice, anything like that, so they didn't have to think too long about it. It is my hope to show that the COVID-19 pandemic has changed the quality of life for companion dogs by either increasing their owner's commitment to them or decreasing it. A lot of people take care of their dogs, all that kind of stuff during a normal kind of day, but with social isolation and all that kind of stuff, they could have had more time to spend with the dog, and that could have affected how the dog perceived them as well. And I do currently have over 1,500 responses that are in my survey. And I'm going to be completing my data analysis in the next couple weeks. Next slide, please. However, if you'd be willing to participate in my survey, feel free to do so. It's completely voluntary, and all I ask is that you are a dog owner and be over the age of 18. I'm always looking for new data and from all across the United States. But if you have any more questions, please let me know. Thank you for listening and have a great day.
Hi, everyone. My name is Shrita Sharma. I am a fourth year psychology major on the pre-medical track with minors in Spanish and chemistry. I really wanted to do my thesis about interpersonal relations and lifestyle influences that could potentially contribute to human development. So I chose to join the Interpersonal Sensitivity Lab run by Dr. Frank Berneri. After countless journal clubs, I chose the topic of sports and personality development for my thesis, and also went a bit further to look at the gender disparities associated with sports, specifically regarding the effects of Title IX. The goal of my research was to determine whether playing sports as children influences personality in adulthood. I studied this by creating a retrospective
I think that Shrita's video and or sound may have stopped out. So we will wait maybe a second more to see if she comes back. One of the many downsides of having to do things in this virtual world. So hopefully we can at least get her back into the breakout session and we'll see what we can do with that. So Shrita, are you back?
I am so sorry.
That's okay, go ahead.
Okay, did you hear anything at all?
We heard just the first part of your title and your focus.
Okay, well, I will go starting off after my focus. Thank you so much for bearing with me. My Wi-Fi just had to cut out. But the goal of my research was to determine whether playing sports as children influences personality in adulthood. And I studied this by creating a retrospective online assessment, which was taken by students at OSU enrolled in introductory psychology courses. The assessment included relevant demographics, current personality traits, enjoyment of sports, and a variety of other variables. In the interest of time, I will focus on one of the six results that I produced, which describes how enjoyment of sports leads to a healthy personality, and this can be seen on the next slide. So before I dive into my results, I want to quickly describe what constitutes a healthy personality. The personality traits I used are known as the Big Five or five-factor model, or you may know them as the OSU traits, which are outlined on the slide. Research has shown that people with healthy personalities are high in extroversion, low in neuroticism, high in conscientiousness, high in openness, and high in agreeableness. So to outline the difference and to avoid having thousands of variables, my study only focused on neuroticism and extroversion. The graph shows the calculated mean healthy personality on the y-axis, and the x-axis shows how much the participants enjoyed sports on a scale of 1 to 5. The right side of the graph shows the people who enjoyed playing sports the most, while the left side shows people who did not enjoy sports. Of the 144 participants, we found that those with a healthy personality enjoyed sports significantly more than those with an unhealthy personality. The 30 males in the study did not display a significant relationship, while the 114 females in the study actually enjoyed sports significantly more than those without healthy personalities. You can see the trend line on this graph, which is showing that there is a general positive trend seen between sports enjoyment and healthy personalities for both males and females. So now it's time to figure out why this is true, which I will discuss on the next slide. My results could indicate that playing sports as children influences personality in adulthood, and sports could be indicative of developing healthy personalities. Based on my research, I have many theories that could explain these findings. Research shows that children who play sports are more physically fit and have higher self-esteem, and countless studies have shown that a good self-concept and self-esteem are related to a healthy personality. So there could be an indirect relationship between sports and healthy personalities. Another theory is that the sheer exposure of social interaction in sports allows children to develop interpersonal skills that would benefit their personality development, leading to that healthy personality. I hope to have a more definite answer to this question by the end of my thesis process. Thank you all for listening to my short presentation. I look forward to answering any questions you may have in the breakout room.
Wonderful. Thank you so much, Rita. And thanks to all of our students. What amazing presentations. And every time I hear from students, especially in sessions like this, just the range of research at OSU is truly astonishing. So also a big shout out to all of the faculty who are supporting our students doing this great work.